Hi, everybody. Greg Fox with Wesh 2 News and Wesh.com, and this is another in our series of debates leading up to the general election. Right now, we're going to focus on State House District 39. Now, this district covers northwest Orange County from Winter Garden and Ocoee, north to Apopka and the Lake County line, and a small portion of West Seminole County as well. The incumbent is Republican Doug Bankson and the challenger, Democrat Marsha Summersill. Thank you very much, both of you, for joining us so voters can learn a little bit more about you, because as we record this now, a few weeks away, we're going to see mail ballots going out, registration closing, and then people starting to early vote. So thanks for being here. First, I'll give you each a minute to tell us a little bit about yourself and why you think you should be elected. We'll start with Ms. Summersill. Go ahead.
Excellent. My name is Marsha Summersill, and I'm actually a Florida native. I graduated from Apopka High School, and I am someone who is very dedicated to the needs of the citizens of this state. I'm a child abuse expert. I ran a medically forensic team out of Arnold Palmer Hospital that covered Orange and Osceola counties. I'm also an attorney, a certified mediator, and a guardian ad litem. And I use these skills in order to aid the citizens of our state, and I've also done a lot of public service. The reason I'm running is because my brother died in 2023 due to the lack of health care. He was a private insurance person, and he lost his insurance due to the extent of his hospitalization. As a result of that, Ray's care declined, and unfortunately, they told me they're going to have to ship my brother out of state in order for him to receive continued care. Part of that issue is because we did not pull down Medicaid funding because Ray had to rely on that for his care. I also saw other patients who were horribly neglected who did not receive that care because they were also Medicaid patients. So I'm here to make changes to benefit the citizens of this state.
All right, thank you very much. Mr. Banks, and 1 minute for you, please.
Yes, thanks, Greg. Thanks, Wesh 2, and thank you for viewing today. My name is Doug Banks, and I am your state representative. I'm a pastor, a pilot, a police chaplain, but my favorite title is Papa. You know, I believe that as a pastor, it's taught me the importance and the value of serving other people. And I think that's what is at the core of being a public servant. The politician term has taken such a terrible connotation. We can't be here for ourselves and for our titles. We have to be here to serve the people. As an instrument-rated pilot, it's taught me to see things at the long term, to see it from the 30,000-foot level, to plan ahead, to make sure to deal with contingencies that you can't see coming. The weather changes, and it's different where you land than when you planned. And so we have to have things such as reserves. We have to have good, sound fiscal policy for the long term. As a police chaplain, I know that safety is job one. And having served the first responders, we need to make sure and stand with them and support them. I've been able to pass some important legislation that was top priority for them in the last couple of terms. And it's so important to me, but my favorite is Papa, and that means family. That's what we're all here for, and that's who I want to serve.
All right, thank you both for those introductions. You mentioned legislation a second ago, so let's stick with you, Mr. Bankson. What exactly would you say is, in your short term in the legislature, the most important bill that you've gotten passed, and what would be the first one you'd file if you're reelected?
Well, again, I was actually able to pass 10 bills in my two terms there as either the direct sponsor or the prime co-sponsor. And for me, I think, again, public safety is such a key issue. One of the first one that rises up to me is called the after-hour illegal alcohol sales. We called it the hookah bill. And this is something that as we begin to find out the issue from Orange County Sheriff's Department, this was the top of their priority, and they asked us to do something about it. We had the alcohol sales that were going on after hours illegally. They were drawing gang violence. They were drawing organized crime. But the most disgusting thing was that they had young women there who were tattooed, scanned as though they were cattle and chosen for service. We see the trafficking issue. So they said it's basically a slap on the wrist. We need stronger legislation. And because of that, we were able to bring that to a felony charge and shut these down. There were 96 of these operating in Orange County alone. And so we were able to give the tools there. There's so many different ones. I have my vertiports bill that I've worked hard on, came that close to passing. But if I were to pass, it would be between that and my legal tender bill.
Okay. And again, I'm sorry. Your first bill that you would file? One. Just pick one.
If What's I can pick one, important? I'd say legal tender bill.
Legal tender bill. Mm-hmm. Ms. Summersill, what would be the first bill that you would file? And I heard Medicaid a little while ago. As we know, Florida, under Republican leadership, has not opted in for Medicaid expansion.
Correct.
Would you start there or someplace else?
I would start there, and also I would like to address the affordability issue, the homeowners insurance. The current legislation that was passed focused on the providers. There was a $3 billion bailout in 2022. The concern is that the other issues that are accountable and have not been reviewed to cause the increase in our rates, my rate went up 300%. After my brother's death, I got a bill for $8,800 from a $2,200 bill after these laws were passed. So my focus is on getting us at a better situation so we're not spending so much out of pocket for the same coverage. What was not addressed are the affiliated companies that are with insurance agencies. There was an attempt to do a grant for deductibles. However, there was also suppression for us to file claims. So the grant is not going to be used. So we need to focus on the homeowners. We need to focus on us, what we're spending daily in our households, to ensure that we can afford the expenses that we have.
Ms. Somersill, just a follow-up now. We've talked about bills that Mr. Bankson has passed, and we've heard some of your ideas. For the voters, please be specific. He's been serving. You want to serve.
Correct.
In what areas where do you think he has not served the voters as well as perhaps yourself? And if so, I need you to be specific about how you would be different in your leadership.
The first area is affordability. The issue in what I've noticed on what was the excuse for not addressing the other areas the insurance companies have identified as a reason why their rates are so high is a concern, and that's what I would do different. Mm-hmm. Part of the issues that impact our rates are not just the hurricanes, not just the lawsuits that tend to be relied upon as to why they've done these adjustments. It's actually also affiliated companies, the fees that they charge, the commissions that they charge. And the major companies, the parent company, actually can have an ownership within these affiliated companies. So there's other avenues that we can do to help address these premiums directly. And I would like to do that. In addition, I would pull down, obviously, the Medicaid money. One of the reasons cited by the legislation was that they didn't want to have to incur the additional cost it's associated because, obviously, state has to contribute once those federal funds come down. However, I saw $3 billion given to insurance companies. Mm-hmm. So I would put the needs of the people first. Your health comes first.
Outside of insurance, do you feel Mr. Bankson has not served the district well?
I think that we have some areas. I personally was impacted. I was impacted through the decision not to pull down Medicaid money. I was impacted by the decision not to appropriately address what was going on with our insurance rates. So with that, after these bills were passed, I felt that it was necessary for somebody to come in and bring a balance. Right now we have a supermajority. There tends to be just an autonomy where they can just make any laws that they want. I don't see proper debate. I don't see proper research. I don't see proper information to support the directions that they've been going. Some of the bills have what I call partial success. But if they were properly done, I think that we would have seen better results. And that's why I'm stepping in, is to ensure that we can get that done.
Okay, so I want to go back to Mr. Bankson now. We're going to give you 2 minutes because she's addressed a couple of different things here. Some people would say a supermajority doesn't give the other party a chance to listen. Other people might say a supermajority means you get things done more quickly. How do you see it?
Well, again, just to address the issues there, I absolutely disagree. But I agree with this, that putting the issues first, that's one of the main reasons why I went to Tallahassee, was the same thing, to deal with our insurance issues. And we literally, right after the election, there was special session called, and so we hit it head on. Again, when you look at the data, it is overwhelming. 8% of the claims, 80% of the litigation. That's not the only issue, but that's not the only thing that we addressed. We also had the roofing issue. Again, I don't want to vilify any particular industry. We need attorneys. We need roofers. There are good actors and bad actors everywhere, including behind pulpits. So, you know, the bottom line is we need to do what's right. So we begin to address that and deal with that issue. We also address the loophole about the assignment of benefits, which was causing all of the turnover, everyone paying for everyone else's roof at that point. And so we saw the skyrocket. But the other issue that really, two other issues, one is the reinsurance. 44 cents out of every dollar goes to the reinsurance. So our insurers are buying insurance. And so what we did to fund the CAT fund was to help bring that around. Citizens was going under. It had an artificial cap put on back when Governor Crist was here. And sadly, it kept it, instead of being that last resort, it became the first resort, and it began to literally take on water to the point it would be insolvent. So we dealt with all of those issues. You know, we have to make sure and understand too the bad politics out of Washington that have caused an incredible inflation. This is a terrible issue because part of the expense has doubled. You know, I'm developed different buildings and different properties. It costs double now to rebuild. So that's part of it, even with everything being brought under. I do believe and do agree that we need to look at the insurance industry themselves. We authorize the OIR to have more authority to oversee that, but we need to look at why are people who have paid a premium for 20 years suddenly being canceled because of the roof? We need to look into those things and do more. But what we've done has begun. Here's the thing, we have 10 new companies coming back into the state, and there's more on that issue.
I'm gonna give you 30 more seconds because I want you to address this. The OIR, the Office of Insurance Regulation, indicates that there are 36 companies that have either agreed to keep the rates the same or to lower them, and those requests have been approved. But we're still getting the emails and still getting the phone calls in the newsroom that are from people that are saying, Citizens is dropping me. The private insurer is twice as much or three times as much. It doesn't sound like the fix is really setting in. Is this something we're going to have to wait for another year or two or three?
No, actually what the analysts told us in the beginning was it's going to take time to turn this ship around. Part of the problem was once we passed the legislation, there was a rush to put in lawsuits into the pipeline. So over these years, these lawsuits were still there. Even though the regulations changed, the lawsuits were still in place and they had to have the time to play themselves out. We now, again, as I mentioned, there are now 10 new companies coming back into the state. Because if we don't have a market-based solution, it will be a band-aid that will end up exploding even further. But we also did something directly for the consumers. As my insurance increased an incredible amount, wind mitigation through the My Safe Florida Home Act has created a tremendous opportunity and caused rates to fall, those who will follow that, up to 50% and even more.
All right, and you have a final 30 seconds to conclude. Do you think this is a fix that needs to be fixed to more and a whole lot more?
I'm going to say a whole lot more. One of the reasons is that 40% from the three major providers, 40% of the claims are not paid, period. So you're relying on partial statistics on a fraction of claims. So a fraction of claims that actually go through require litigation because there is a high likelihood they were denied. So as a homeowner, when I want to use the product that I have been paying for approximately 15 years, and then I'm told, no, I cannot, my recourse is to get legal counsel. And we are taking those options away.
It sounds like we could go on and on with this, but we're going to move on. Of course, the district includes the beautiful Wekiwa Springs State Park and one of the most protected waterways in the state of Florida, which is the Wekiwa River. However, in recent weeks, there have been some discussions about putting hotels, golf courses, pickleball courts, and other kinds of recreation in at least 9 of our state parks. That position has now been put to the side for a little more discussion, perhaps a little more public comment. So let's stay with Ms. Somersill here. Is this a good idea, bad idea? And what would you do to ensure that at least in our area, Wekiwa Springs State Park in the district would be protected?
It's a bad idea to develop on protected lands, including our state parks. I think that we have some issues. We are unable to ensure infrastructure is in place already with the volume of growth that we have. And for us to add more options for this development to impact our environment is contrary to what the needs of the citizens of this state have. I am aware that in the future that we are looking at some issues with our water supply. And I think it's critical. It's critical that our parks are preserved, and in no way, fashion, or form is it appropriate to encroach on those areas. I'm someone who has always advocated for the protection of our environment. I've worked with organizations, I've volunteered, and I'm from this state. I've gone to Rock Springs, Wakaiva Springs, and those are the places that we absolutely love to enjoy, and we definitely don't want those destroyed. And I will say that it was a little bit offensive on how that occurred and how it was released, that information. So definitely protect our parks.
Mr. Bankson, do you agree with any part of the development plan that was in the works and has now been put on hold?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely not. I heard this through the news process. It was ridiculous how it was rolled out. And my first thought was the song Pave Paradise to put up the parking lot. You know, we do not need to develop these places. We need to keep them pristine. That's why they're there. But you mentioned something's very important. We need to protect our watershed and to watch out for our wildlife corridor and all of these state parks. They're there for a reason. I was born in Southern California, and one of the greatest errors they made was not watching out for their water supply. And so I'm heightened to that issue that we need to protect those things. We need to protect the value of the great outdoors. There are many golf courses that could use some help, that can use resurrecting without taking those lands. So we cannot take what protects our water supply to allow that water to go down to the aquifer. We need to keep that pristine, make sure that the people have. I do think that it, you know, is well-intentioned when they say, well, we want to get people out. But if we get out there, but we've changed it, what have we done? So I just absolutely disagree with it.
All right, take note, a Republican and Democrat in the same room agree. All right, you don't have to, no, please, don't salute each other. No,
hey, I'm just kidding. We're breaking the mold, breaking the mold.
So now this next question is tailor-made for this too. We'll stick with Mr. Bankson for this one to start. District 39 is fairly evenly split between Republicans and Democrats. There are about 35,000 voters that are independents. So I guess I would say, starting with you, talk to them and persuade them that keeping you in office is the right move for an independent that may be looking at a lot of different things and not just an R and a D on the ballot.
Well, you know, again, I think you made a point that I've seen so much of this ditch warfare, quite honestly, in politics. Not that we can't be strong, and we should. We can be convincing, but, you know, we don't have to be enemies. We may have enemies of each other's policies, but we need to work together because the people are at stake. While we fight, they suffer, and we need to change that atmosphere. For me, I believe in common sense. You know, we've seen different things happen. The main focus needs to be our economy. We all know that. People are suffering. Real people are having to choose between, you know, gas, food, and medication. That's not right, and we need to continue to work together on that. We need to make sure that our schools have opportunities, and I love what we've done in our school system. It's become a national model. You know, we need to make sure and care about our teachers. I've mentioned to you before my grandmother, who just turned 106 this year and still going. She's a lifelong educator and put a love of education in my heart. And so we need to give all of the options to make sure that every child, not just the wealthy children, but the poor as well, have the option to go which best fits them and give those parents real choice.
Ms. Somersill, talk to the independents.
Yes. I am unique as I do have bipartisan support, and I am also someone who is a moderate in my stances. I do not focus on issues that are not going to directly impact us as citizens, and I'm really very laser focused on ensuring that I address the issues that impact us all. Those issues include affordability, health insurance, car insurance, housing. We have a housing shortage. We have teacher shortage. Our teachers are the lowest paid in the country. That is unacceptable. And obviously, with the success of the school system, they are the best and the highest quality. So we need to be appropriate when we're addressing these issues. I'm also someone who can reach across the aisle. I'm going to get it done. I am not someone who is fixated on partisan politics. It's a waste of my time. My goal is to pass laws that's going to benefit all of you. If you have an issue, I will address it. I think it's important that we do not work in a time, or we don't have time actually anymore. We need to get out of this friction, and we need to get work done.
I want to give Mr. Bankson 30 seconds to answer this question. According to the NEA, Florida's teacher pay is down in the lower two or three in the country. It's $16,000 a year below the national average. What will you do if you're reelected to make sure that more money is going to our teachers?
Yeah, and first, to correct that just a moment, we're actually the highest of the Southeast region. If you compare us to other areas such as the New York, the California, these different ones, they're going to have a higher rate, but they also have a completely different tax base.
I believe we're 48th according to the NEA.
Okay, well,
that is
I but go ahead.
That's not the
okay.
information that
it's
I'm
not
aware
where
of.
Teachers
but the bottom
would
line
want
is
it
this.
To be. Okay,
bottom
so how
line
do we
is
change
this.
That?
It's still too low. And the good news is, again, we have raised it in the past, in my term, $2.35 billion have increased it. When I mention that, the statistic there is starting pay. But that's part of the problem. We can't just have our starting teachers have a higher pay. We need to make sure that those who have been there serving have an increase as well. And so I will continue to push for those increases.
I was going to say, will you put your name on a bill to sponsor an increase in pay, and or would you be a co-sponsor?
I would definitely support those things. I have.
Okay.
We have a very limited number of slots, and I've already got too many bills with the slots that I have is what we're looking at. But that's a key issue, and it's something that I definitely will support.
Maybe you could partner with another representative in the legislature. All right, let's talk about the two controversial amendments that are on the ballot this year. Let's talk first about Amendment 4. It would enshrine abortion rights into the Constitution. Ms. Summersale,
yes.
Are you for it, against it, and why?
I'm 100% for it. I'm a child abuse expert. I've actually had direct cases where a child, a 13-year-old female, was pregnant as a result of sexual assault. She was over the six-week mark, and this was obviously during Roe v. Wade. And if I were in a situation where I would have to get permission from an individual who has zero knowledge of the circumstances that she was in order for her to get the proper medical care, that is absolutely atrocious. In addition, I believe that this amendment will help because Roe v. Wade actually has provisions. Some of the bizarre things that I'm hearing are absolutely asinine, that a woman should have the ability to make these decisions. It is between her and her doctor. Now, does it mean that I'm advocating for someone to get a procedure done no matter what? No. It means that it is none of my business. I am not qualified to make that decision. I am not a judge. There's only one judge, and that is not on this planet. And I really feel that it's imperative that we allow and we provide women the right to make this decision for themselves.
Mr. Bankson, for or against Amendment 4, and why?
Well, I'm against the amendment. The biggest issue is how it's worded, and it's very deceptive, and it's very concerning. The problem is it completely puts it away from common people to continue to deal with this issue. Once it becomes that amendment, it's now beyond the reach of legislation to address those things, such as having parental consent. There's no parental consent in this bill, the way it's stated. Literally, you have to have consent to get a tattoo. Any other procedure, you have to have consent. This says notification, but that's deceptive. And as I've talked with real voters, they're like, I didn't recognize that. There's no definitions on viability, on healthcare professional. These are dangerous things, and it leaves it way too wide open. I believe in a culture of life. I believe in protecting women's rights. It's very important to me. But what about the women's rights who have no voice? This is a real issue for me, and I believe it's something that's monumental. As a nation, we're contending with this. We shouldn't be judgmental, but we also need to be very thoughtful and reflective.
Ms. Summersale wants to have something to say, but I just have to ask you. I mean, nearly every justice on the state Supreme Court, which approved the wording on this amendment, was appointed by Republican Governor Ron DeSantis.
Well,
they think the wording is
good enough.
It was
a 3-4 vote. And regardless of who, you know, we see different ones who have been appointed by Republican presidents that went completely different than where they thought they would be. They're supposed to be impartial, and they have to make that judgment. But I disagree with that decision because of the issue of protecting all life. And I talked with someone about that. I said, is that a human being? If this is a human being, this is where we missed it with Roe v. Wade. And they themselves said this. Mm-hmm. They shifted from dealing with the person to dealing with the privacy. I'm a big proponent of privacy, but it cannot override the rights of every person, and that's what we have to really focus on.
Okay, 30 seconds.
Yes. Viability is a definable term. The reason that this was passed by the Florida Supreme Court is because it's not ambiguous. The requirement for us to have an amendment is to ensure that the reader understands what it says. So all of that information is not accurate. I really think that when we have something in place to protect women, we benefit everything. There's so many reasons why women need this procedure, whether it's IVF, whether it's a miscarriage, whether it's a DNC, ectopic pregnancy, whether it did the ovary or the egg did not attach to the wall. It is imperative that they get medical care when they need it.
Okay. You're for it. You're against it. Let's move on to Amendment 3. Would legalize recreational marijuana. Mr. Bankson, for it, against it?
Again, I disagree with what you said there. Viability is a moving target. Different ones have defined it differently. If it had been defined in the amendment, it would have been clear. And more, again, all of these issues we could really sit down and discuss over a cup of coffee and dig into. But Amendment 3, I'll tell you, I would really encourage everyone watching to go and visit learnaboutsam.org. Smart Approaches to Marijuana. This is a bipartisan approach. This has gone nationwide. They've taken the issues, again, having been born in California, having lived in Colorado, and seeing what it's done not only in those states, but Oregon. I've talked with legislators there who say, please don't allow this in your state. It's had an economic impact that is devastating. There are things based on a 2014 study that are absolutely been proven false statistically by 2019. One out of every four deaths on the Colorado roadways, where this is very rampant, one out of four are attributed to a marijuana usage. There's so many more issues, and with our short amount of time, I just encourage everyone, look up that website, look it up for yourself. I believe in personal liberty, but this is something that puts too many people at risk. That's why we have speed limits. I like to go fast, but I have to yield to that when it's gonna harm others.
All right, Mr. Bankson is in now. Go ahead, Ms. Somersilla, your thoughts on this amendment.
Yes, I believe that as long as the proper provisions are in place as far as regulation. The amendment itself notes that regulation is something that has to be in place. I do know they have looked at the other models from the other states. Over 20 states have it legalized, and there's been significant income produced from the sale of this product. So I do believe the amendment is appropriate, that most likely it will pass, and I do feel that proper regulation is required to ensure that we address the concerns.
What regulation specifically?
Well,
what
it's needs, the substance.
I mean, to me, the big fear among law enforcement is that we're going to have more impaired drivers, and people may or may not know. I mean, they're used to what a breathalyzer does to read alcohol inebriation, but the testing for marijuana is somewhat less sure because marijuana stays in your system longer, but may not be impairing you at the time you're tested. So how do we figure that out and get past that part of it?
In order for a law enforcement officer to pull you over, the sobriety test includes the physical condition of the person. Yeah. So that's kind of a no-brainer. And also there's an odor, or if they're using a vape. And then, of course, if they're able to stop them, they can ask to search the vehicle to determine if the person does have possession of the substance at the time. That is part of the regulation piece. That was my caveat on there. So proper provisions, I think, are critical in order to ensure public safety. Now, do we think it's going to increase use? Likelihood individuals are already using the product, and that we are not going to see a substantial increase in the use. So I don't necessarily think we're going to have the correlation. We're just not going to have a bunch of people arrested for possession. So I think as long as the proper provisions in place, again, research, knowledge, and doing your homework to make sure that we have that done is critical in this process as well.
Mr. Bankson, go ahead. You look like you want to throw something in here. Go ahead.
Learnaboutsam.org. It really goes into the depth of this. This has been a bipartisan effort on a nationwide scale, looking at the reported profits. I'm not going to sell out our next generation for profits. I'm just not going to do it, popular or not. What I do want to do is protect people's freedom. So how do we find that balance? Again, you really brought it up. Our law enforcement is very concerned because you cannot know these things when the statistics clearly show one in four accidents had an influence of marijuana directly tied to that. When you look at the statistics, they have increased exponentially in these other states. It will happen here. And we've seen it create such social issues that I think it's a Pandora's box that we're not ready to open.
basically, yes on 3 and 4, no on 3 and 4. Okay, we've got it. I want to get back to a different part of education. A moment ago, we talked about the amount of money the teachers are getting and whether or not that should be brought up and how it should be brought up. As far as per pupil spending, though, we didn't talk about that. In K-12 spending, it has increased slightly each year under Governor DeSantis. Mm-hmm. But again, it's still rated to be in the lower 5 to 10. It might be number 8 from the bottom. In the meantime, in this year's budget, $2.8 billion will be spent for over 313,000 private school vouchers in the state of Florida. Mr. Banksner, are you okay with that, if that's money that could have been used for K-12 public schools?
Yeah, and I'll tell you why. Because the infrastructure needs for public schools is completely supported from other tax means. So it actually alleviates part of the pressure that has been for a lack of teachers and crowded classrooms. At the same time, it's creating opportunity. Here's the issue. It has to be student-centric. We have to look on the children. What's best for them? At the same time, we must fund our public schools. If you look at the budget, we increased 28.4 billion to K through 12 public schools. We also passed legislation this last year that cut the red tape. Everything the public schools were saying, we can't be in a competitive place here with private institutions. We went through and cut red tape to make sure that everything, everyone can prosper. And so the school choice isn't just about public versus private, it's public versus public, charter, private, home, all the different areas that make sure the student does well. And when this was first rolled out a few years ago, Miami began to show that the statistics in the public schools were performing better. The students were performing better, less dropout rate, more people getting across the line, because when you follow the student and get them in something that they can be interested in, it will strengthen them.
Ms. Somersill, to continue on that theme, mm-hmm. Some have said that K-12 public schools are performing better because you have 313,000 students who are not crowding classrooms and making it possible for teachers to have more one-on-one time with students in classrooms that are smaller. So isn't that a benefit of vouchers?
Whether or not a voucher is beneficial, is that a particular question? In certain circumstances, yeah. Yes, I think vouchers are perfectly fine. What I have a concern with is when money is provided to our public schools through another source, whether it's federal money, whether they had that COVID relief money, and when they get something to help them out, they lose something. It becomes an offset as opposed to supplementing the needs of the school. We have a massive population increase. We're looking at millions of people coming into our state. We're having to build schools to accommodate these kids. We don't have the teachers there for them. So we absolutely must properly fund our schools. If you are taking money from the public school in order to fund vouchers, that's where the problem is. You need to have both. You cannot pick one. So I really feel that the funding has to be appropriate. I think that I do family law. My clients would like to have the option of a charter school, particularly when parents divorce and they need that neutral location. So there is a benefit to that. But do not take away the needs from public education.
All right, we've covered a lot of ground, mm-hmm. amendments, education, hurricane insurance, and more. It's time for closing statements. Mr. Banks, in 1 minute, please.
Oh, my. Well, again, public vouchers, that's the people's money. We need to give parents the choice for their children's education. I believe that's one of the most important things. To me, economy, education, employment, our environment, energy, these are key issues that I'm laser focused on. I've worked for the Chamber of Commerce, or actually served on the board for 19 years in Apopka, and was a chamber chairman part of that time. I've served at the City Commission for 6 years as a commissioner and a vice mayor. I oversee almost 50 employees and a budget of $3 million. I have the issues that, and I've dealt with the experience that help deal with real world issues, real world problems. And my focus, again, is to serve the people that send me there. It would be my great honor and privilege to go and serve you in Tallahassee once again, passing 8 bills, bringing $18 million back to the governor's desk to be signed. He cut $3 million of that. I was not happy. But again, advocating for our real world needs, housing, all the different issues that we're seeing here. These are things that I'm laser focused on and we'll go after. We've got a great future. We're number one in our economy in the nation, and we're number one in our education results. Let's bring some more funds there and make sure that we succeed in every measure.
Ms. Somersill, one minute, please.
Yes. I actually ran a team for Orange and Osceola County, and I've had to deal with government budgets. I had to deal with offset, and I also had to deal with low funding. So I know the consequences, and I know the reason people succeed is because of passion, because of knowing that their job is public service. And even though my team was underfunded, We had the best results, and we saved thousands of children. That's what these teachers are doing, and I want to give them more resources. The issue is affordability. I want to make sure that you are directly impacted, that you have lower insurance premiums. I will do everything in my power to do that, that you have access to health care, that we pull down Medicaid money, because if something happens to you, you're one paycheck away from losing your private coverage. That's unacceptable. We need to have those services there for you. It's your health. It's your prosperity. It's your ability to thrive in this state. It's your ability to afford to live in this state. I grew up poor, very poor. I lived on Martin Street down the road from Apopka High School. I had no resources. I was adopted by my grandmother. I worked hard, and I'm going to work hard for you to get everything that you need.
All right. Thank you both. Our Democrat, Marcia Summersill, Republican, Doug Bankson, thank you very much for sharing your ideas and your views. This has been a debate in Florida House District 39, and that's in Orange and Seminole counties. This is West.com, and we thank you for watching.